Welcome back. This is the fourth video of our series on PPC. If you haven't watched the previous ones, you can do so by clicking on the link to the playlist in the top right corner. As always, the references are in the description. Last time, I explained what PPC is in theory. Today, we'll take a more practical approach by looking at the classroom context. We'll see what forms PPC instruction could take and what benefits developing PPC can have for language learners. PPC allows more than strictly monolingual uses of language. It allows speakers to use their whole repertoire when communicating. Code switching, translation, translanguaging, all those strategies give plurilinguals more options than monolinguals to communicate efficiently. This flexible use of language helps improve both discourse skills and what we call metalinguistic awareness, that is, knowledge about language in addition to knowledge of languages. Recent research shows that students' cognition improved as a result of developing their PPC. Contrary to some beliefs, PPC and plurilingual instruction doesn't hinder learning of the target language. On the contrary, it allows learners to acquire proficiency in new languages without diminishing their fluency in their more dominant languages. But developing PPC has more benefits than just language learning. Plurilingual instruction helps learners to develop empathy and to relate to others and their language or culture. PPC then permits learners to be more aware and accepting of diverse plurilingual and pluricultural identities. The notion of language and cultural collaboration illustrates this perfectly by presenting all plurilingual repertoires of students, teachers, and parents as useful tools for learning, thus fostering understanding and collaboration between students from different backgrounds by creating safe spaces to engage their PPC. After all those positive results in research, there is a call for teachers to implement plurilingual pedagogies and develop their students' PPC. In the next video, we'll end this series by a concluded statement looking at implications for teaching and future research.